Social justice simulations provide instructors with a dynamic and adaptable teaching tool. They facilitate the in-depth study of social justice issues. They enable students to apply a range of broad theoretical principles to specific case studies, and they build practical skills in a safe learning environment. I designed a simulation about self-determination in West Papua, Indonesia, for example. There are three decisions to make when selecting a simulation or designing your own: determining the trigger, creating the role play, and developing the simulation exercises. We will work through each of these in turn. Social justice simulations work best when students respond to a specific incident of abuse or violation that affects an individual or group, that is, the trigger. While problems of social justice are more complex than that, root causes such as structural inequality or ethnic division manifest themselves in specific cases of abuse, and triggers provide the hook for student learning.
Triggers usually precede classroom exercises and are generally presented in written or video form to initiate student response. Triggers can be real or invented. In my simulation, which examined disability and privacy rights, I invented a trigger which dramatised real issues. A blind person was compelled to reveal her voting choices to a pushy and opinionated official who took her to the voting booth. I also developed preparatory video materials, relying on well-known legal scholars to generate student interest.
My trigger involved a real situation: the Australian government's transfer of asylum seekers to detention centres at overseas locations. But within this context, I created a fictional gay asylum seeker detained in a country that prohibits homosexuality.
The role play is the core element of the social justice simulation, unfolding in a culminating meeting of some kind, allowing students to prepare and formulate responses in character. The role play is centered around local, national, or international events, such as a community consultation, a legislative hearing, or an international UN meeting.
Role plays, like triggers, can be based on a real activity or can be invented. Real meetings, such as government hearings or UN committee meetings, are useful as a teaching tool because they explain policies and decision-making processes.
Our role plays simulated a meeting of CEDAW in which students played the roles of government delegations and NGOs appearing before the CEDAW committee. This highlighted the links between women's rights, Indigenous rights and disability rights.
I based my first role play on a meeting hosted by the UN Refugee Agency. Organisations and advocates attempted to develop action plans in response to changing asylum seeker policies. The second meeting simulated a hearing before the Australian Senate Committee for Legal and Constitutional Affairs, where students took the roles of advocates and government officials.
I designed a role play in which participants had to make oral submissions about the rights and treatment of Australia's Indigenous peoples to an imagined panel of inquiry. By inventing a meeting, I was able to manage the requirements of the meeting to ensure that all students had a chance to participate. To add weight to the simulation, I invited experts in the field of Indigenous rights to play the roles of the panel members, resulting in a challenging and exciting experience for the students.
My simulation was a hybrid of real and invented. My students learn about human security, which focuses on the security needs of the individual rather than the state. Such a shift is messy and complex, and my simulation illustrated that. It focused on the fictional country of Zambia that emerged from civil war, with government accused of widespread abuses against an ethnic minority. Students played out a UN Security Council meeting in characters from different groups: the government of Zambia, domestic opposition, international civil society, and members of the Security Council. In these roles, they negotiated with each other in order to resolve the situation.
Once you have a trigger and a designated meeting for your role play, you'll need to determine how students will prepare and carry out their roles or responses. For this, you'll need to run simulation exercises.
Students engaged in several simulation exercises that challenged them to recast their legal arguments for different audiences and purposes, such as for news outlets, social media, political lobbying, and public education. Other exercises helped them go beyond legal research and legal responses, identifying tactics, data, stakeholders, partners and opponents, so that they could think more creatively about how they could achieve their desired outcome.
In my simulation, students used tactical mapping to understand the dynamics between government and non-government actors and where the law fits in. They then prepared oral statements and designed promotional material to work out how to meld legal arguments and moral ones.
My simulation was built on a series of rounds. Rounds are useful because you can require a definite outcome at the end of each one. This provides students with a clear structure and time frame, as well as an end goal. One round ended with the UN Security Council having to decide whether or not members wanted to pursue a resolution.
One of the most important and often overlooked aspects of role plays is the debrief, where students step out of character and reflect on the dynamics of the case in a supportive environment. This is important so that students' final role is not that of victim or perpetrator or advocate, but learner, and gives students a chance to match principles and practice.
The debrief helped students make sense of the strong emotions they'd experienced during the role play. After a confronting day of playing powerful perpetrators and resource-poor advocates, this was really valuable.
Social justice simulations can be adapted to alternative teaching environments. We designed our simulation in a class that included both on-site and online students.
Online participation at our simulated CEDAW meeting provided students with the chance to engage with one another and understand the challenges of collaborating using new technologies.
My course had nearly 400 students, so I used real-time audience response software to increase student participation.
For effective simulations, keep in mind the following additional suggestions.
Careful preparation is critical, so provide written instructions well in advance and have someone read them over to ensure that they're clear to students.
If you're relying on external volunteers to play some of the roles in your simulation, give them as much detail as possible about their roles in advance.
Choose a room or space where students can work effectively in groups.
Use props such as flags or gavels to aid with the suspension of disbelief.
Instructors can lessen the anxiety of role plays by assessing not how students perform their roles, but their individual reflections on simulation events.
The simulation process was really good fun. Gave us a chance to work with our classmates in a different way, gave us a chance to think about issues in a completely different way, to think very strategically and actually very practically about how you might operate.
Social justice simulations offer teachers a fantastic opportunity to improve student learning in a creative and stimulating way.